What I think a lot of businesses are getting wrong is that they believe that productivity is the end goal. A lot of businesses, if I'm an executive, if I'm an internal senior leader, right, director and above, I am thinking about output-based things. I am thinking about how many deals we can close. I am thinking about how much revenue we can get per customer or whichever, right? I am going to be very output-based. Too many companies have that as the end goal, and they're not thinking about that reallocation. They're not thinking about actual business line transformation. And so I for the last, probably year with my clients, I've been talking about how productivity is a trap. I've been forcing them to think outside of productivity from the beginning. It might be employee morale, which eventually has impact on like HR productivity because you don't have to hire as many people because churn is reduced, right? Employee churn. So that is definitely one. But the second is if you are only focused on productivity, if you're only focused on individuals being able to code things faster, you are going to miss the much bigger shift that's happening in business, which is the ability to generate completely net new business lines. And so one example that I, throw out, imagine that you are a media and entertainment group and you are making TV shows and movies all the time. Maybe you're even making podcasts, who knows? And so if you are thinking about a productivity lens, right, what might you be thinking? You might be thinking about how do we set up the set faster? How do we, get the audio editing to be faster? How do we book guests faster? You're going to be thinking about a productivity lens. What you are then going to miss and what will fly by you at 110 miles an hour and what your competitors are thinking about is how should you actually reinvent that process and that business from a foundation level? And so maybe in the next 10 years, the way that we actually create content or the type of content that we create should completely change. And if you've only thought about your business or your workflows through a productivity lens, you will miss this much bigger transformation. And so a lot of people are on this like 35 mile an hour street thinking about productivity when actually what they should do is get the hell out of that car and actually look at what's happening next to them on the freeway, which is that business model shift. You can see it in startups. You can see it in Silicon Valley. You can see it in some regions more than others. The US is definitely ahead. But if you are not paying attention, you will miss it.
Something I wanted to ask you also is how do you identify these deadweight tasks? Which mm-hmm. is, I guess, foundational to reorganizing the way that you do your business. So instead of just doing things quicker, like I could do, code a Python app quicker, how do I identify the tasks that I'm doing that are just totally irrelevant?
Can I tell you about a tool that I built?
Yes.
Okay. So I, too, was trapped in that question of, like, for the last 2.5 years, I've told people a pretty normal response, which is write down all the tasks that you're doing. Like for 2 weeks, track down every single thing that you're doing. Keep a little sheet of paper on the side as you write down tasks. And then at the end of the 2 weeks, take a look at those tasks, kind of couple them and group them, and then try and assign AI to help you with some of those tasks. So the tool that I built, which I showed to my clients and anyone listening, by the way, can build their own, is you type in your job title and the company that you work for, and it goes through 10 steps. I'll give you the abbreviated version. Don't worry, we're not going to turn this into a podcast about the tool. First is it lists out your potential job description. Then it lists out what it guesses your tasks are. You can then eliminate or add. Then it guesses who you most likely collaborate with and then expands their tasks. Then it looks at those tasks, categorizes them by what can AI do today? What is AI likely to do with the next model release? And what is AI like nowhere near touching? What things feel very human only, like building relationships or something? Then it looks at what AI agents can help you with. Then it looks at your role being helped with AI agents. Anyways, by the end of it, it tells you which job you will likely have in the next coming years, what tasks you will likely be taking on, and what an AI agent or an AI system in general is taking advantage of. So long way of saying, right, TLDR, ask AI, give it your job, give it what you think your tasks are, have a back and forth conversation saying, I'm worried about AI taking my job. I don't understand AI. Tell me about what AI agents could do in my type of role. How should I be thinking about AI evolution for my role? What sort of things should I be upskilling on now so that I have a career in 2 years? Those sorts of things you can ask an AI system or people in your field to be thinking through. But I literally built an AI tool so that I could answer this at scale.
So there is an undercurrent of fear that you kind of touched on about people being like, okay, this can now do things. How do you describe, not do things, what did you say?
I was even going to say it's not an undercurrent, it's like a tidal wave that's about to come up.
It is,
yeah.
But people...
No,
are...
do things is, again, the very overly simplistic way of describing AI agents.
So you have this fear then. And then you also mentioned like, okay, productivity, is it necessarily tied to my happiness? Because you have a happy workforce, you're going to see those benefits. You know, that's going to be a knock-on effect later on to your shareholders. So what do you say to people like that? Like who are looking at this being like, wow, these could write SQL queries for me. And that's my whole job. I'm just writing SQL queries. This could do it for me in natural language. Like, what do you say to these people?
Here's how I would be thinking about fear. So first, the lens that conversation topic comes up when I'm talking to C-suite of Fortune 500 companies, where they're running a company of, say, 40,000 people, and they're thinking about how to more deeply embed AI into their workforce and how to get more people to use it and how to hit amazing efficiency, right? And then they come to me and then they go, hey, Allie, we have this amazing tool. We got every single person access to Watson X, Copilot, whichever. And we gave it to every single person in our company. 5% of people are using it.
Yeah.
Now what? And I'm like, because that's not how AI transformation works. And so I ask them, why do you believe people aren't adopting it? To which they usually say, I don't know. There are three key reasons, and fear is one of the biggest. Reason number one, I don't have time to test these things. I'm too busy. My work is too crazy, right? Too busy is definitely number one. And that's an excuse for everything. Number two is, I don't know how this thing works. No one's taught me this thing. It looks like a blank page. It looks like Google. What can this thing actually do? And number three is, I'm not going to train a system that's going to take over my job. Why would I do this? And so I think if these CEOs actually talk to their employees, they would probably figure out that like 80%+ of their employees are terrified of AI taking over their jobs. And I mean, again, at an average company, there are going to be some tech companies that are way more pro AI. There are going to be certain departments that are much more pro AI. Every single study, including I think one from IBM that I was looking at, sales, product, marketing, and engineering. Those are the four that are always going to be pro AI. As you figure out why people are not actually using these AI systems, you are going to come across the finding that every single business has found, which is people are scared. If you approach it as, don't be scared, just use it. And then you walk away as an executive and you fly to Hawaii and go on this nice vacation, adoption won't change and you're probably planting seeds for like mutiny, right? So to prevent this revolt, you actually have to address that fear. You as a executive have to stand up at your next all hands or whoever's leading your AI work. You have to stand up and you have to say, I know you are scared. I've talked to 20 of you. I've had surveys go out. I've read studies. I've been in these meetings where it gets brought up or whatever. I'm acknowledging that. Here is how we're going to address it as a company. Here is what role AI is and is not going to take. Here's the type of policy that we're going to have. Here's tools that we are going to use and which ones we're not. You have to be vocal and upfront about that role because too many business leaders are taking this approach of like, if we just scoot this fear under, you know, sweep it under the table, we're going to be fine. You know, people will eventually use it. Let's just force them to use it, right? Let's measure their success based on whether they use it or not and just force them into it. It doesn't work. It just doesn't work. It didn't work with cloud, didn't work with analytics. Not every single person figured out how to write SQL queries. We have to be at a stage where people are actually having those conversations, even if it feels difficult in the moment, even if it feels like this weird humanity level conversation that you have not been forced to have. You have to have it.
You've spoken to C-suites. Have they been like receptive to hearing this?
You know, C-suite folks love to be right. And when they're in a group, they are very vocal about, oh no, we've been doing this. Oh yeah, we're totally ahead. Yeah, we've been talking about that for 2.5 years, whatever. You know what happens? I get them into a one-on-one conversation and I'm meeting with the CEO, CFO, CTO, CIO, whichever. And I talk to them and I go, what do you really think? Every single one of them, okay? 2 minutes later, they go, I am terrified.
Really?
I think I'm gonna lose my job. Yes! There was a study that just came out, I think it was from Fortune, that said 79% of CEOs are worried that because they handle AI wrong, they will lose their job in the next 2 years. That is a real stat.
That's unbelievable.
And so these CEOs, they're very worried about making the wrong move because, number one, the economy is so volatile that any sort of thing in the wrong direction could just be a really bad pendulum swing. Number two is a lot of these movements are guesses in the first place. And so they're thinking to themselves, why do I have to be a first mover on this guess? Why can't I let my competitors take the plunge first and I'll figure it out later? And number three is, at our core, as humans, we just want to survive. And so whether you're a CEO or a team lead, you are thinking about, how do I keep my job? And if you believe that the biggest threat is handling AI wrong, you are going to be hesitant. You are going to be, you know, non-declarative about big, scary things because you're saving yourself in the process. And so a lot of the work that I do with C-suite is those deep one-on-one conversations. It ends up sounding a little bit like therapy. I mean, I'm sure you have the same thing with customers too. But so much of it is getting them to a place where they feel safe to make risky moves and to find ways of mitigating risk with AI agents, right? Starting small, that's always gonna be a risk mitigator. Starting internal only, that's always gonna be a risk mitigator. Not having it all on you, right? Who's your bigger AI task force? Who can you actually pull in? Maybe you're a non-technical leader. Great, pull in your CDO, CIO, CTO as your co-lead for this new AI task force. There's so many ways to mitigate risk. Because CEOs are moving to this space and it's so new, they don't know how to navigate. And so I end up being, you know, 30% therapist, but also like 30% captain with them and just being like, here's where you steer the ship. Let's freaking go. And then they find that path and then they can still, you know, bring their own brilliance to the table.